as a city and as a community to reflect the need for a greater awareness of the long-term impacts of our decisions and what we do. So looking forward to being part of this.
Thank you, Mayor Lehman, and I know you all have a few questions or two for him. Next, I'd like to welcome, we have with us from the Chippewas of Georgina, Cynthia Wesley Eskimo.
He's very actively engaged in protecting this beautiful body of water for our future, and I guess one of the things that I'm very keen on is going backwards to go forward.
Next, the CEO of the Lake Simcoe Region Conservation Authority, Gail Wood.
Well, hi, everybody. It is wonderful to be here today, and it's so nice that the rain held off.
Next, another face that needs no introduction, somebody who is very well known to all of you, and that is our MP for Barrie, Patrick Brown.
Thank you, Tony, and it's great to be here today at EcoFest, and I'm involved in the capacity that I am looking at any way we can make Barrie greener. And
next, I'd like you to welcome from Back to Basics, Andrew Miller, to tell us a little bit more about what that is.
Hi everyone, yeah, I'm Andrew Miller with Back to Basics Social Development, a local not-for-profit in town. I'm also the provincial candidate for the Green Party, and so we're in a few hats at this festival, but we're involved in the EcoPod building, the container home there. I've managed that project, and we're working on bringing some involving youth in part of this transition, part of this change, and in being very innovative in our approach. And I'm really proud to be part of this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. And rounding out our round table today is Mike Fox of Transitions Town Barrie. Mike.
Hi, and as Tony said, I'm with Transitions Town, Transition Barrie, which is a local group that I, along with my wife and a number of other people, helped found. I'm neither a scientist nor a politician, nor involved professionally in environmental issues, but I just feel that as a normal citizen, everybody needs to get involved, and that's what brings me here today.
Actions, ideas, plans. Let's talk about Lake Simcoe. We'll open the floor right now, and we're happy to take any of your questions.
I was going to say the first one is always the toughest to get, but thank you, ma'am, for stepping forward and breaking the ice.
Well, I'm actually Marianne Elf from the Council of Canadians, the local Simcoe Region chapter, and of course we were very active in Site 41. But I was just earlier this today, I was talking to Goody Gerna, who is now the past president of the Lake Ladies, and they of course have a new project, and of course we can have a look at that online. But I'm very, very concerned about last year and this year. I'm quite a frequent swimmer, like five times a day or something, and I'm between Barrie and Orillia, and I'm really concerned about the water because there's stuff swimming in there this year and last year that wasn't there the year before. And even the beaver mussels, who have been trying so hard to clean everything up, are no longer really there. There are hardly any left, at least not at the places where I swim. So I'm just wondering how the panel can address that question. Thank you.
Okay, so the quality of what is in our lake. Who would like to open that discussion? Gail? Okay, Gail.
That's a fabulous question, and I have to say that we get asked that question every day of our working lives. And it's a very complex question as well. Lake Simcoe or any body of water is it's a complex ecosystem. So there's a lot of issues, a lot of contaminants in the water that we are working on. And let me talk about zebra mussels first, because you mentioned that. Zebra mussels are an invasive species. They're not natural to Lake Simcoe. So you're saying, right, you know that. But they're also filter feeders. So if many of you have been around for a number of years, you will notice that in some cases the lake is looking cleaner. There's still aquatic weeds out there, vegetation, the biologists call it, but the zebra mussels filter a lot of the green algae in the water and actually make the lake a little cleaner. But they are invasive species, and we've just been studying them now for around the time that they were introduced, which is about, you know, a little over a decade. We really don't know the impact that they're having, but you're quite right. They are dying off in the lake because this isn't the natural habitat for them. Mm-hmm. We don't know what's happening long term when they do die in the lake, because what our concern is, the great concern with Lake Simcoe, and a key indicator is what we call phosphorus. And phosphorus comes from everything, sewage to runoff from land, etc. But we're concerned that when the zebra mussels die off, that they will release phosphorus from their body, and there will be a new recycling of phosphorus in the lake. So we're studying it, and I'm not a scientist either, but I can tell you that it takes many years to figure out what long-term impacts are, particularly when you introduce invasive species into the water body. Now, in terms of the other contaminants that are in there, again, we're monitoring them, everything from phosphorus to nitrogen to bacterial contamination, etc. But if you swim in an area, and let's say it's been raining for quite a while, you can have a lot of flushing of contaminants from certain water courses that are going into the area where you're swimming. And they do tend to surface, even if you have wildlife around there, it can increase bacterial contamination if there's been a lot of wildlife where you're now swimming. So what happens is, I told you there's about 35 major rivers and streams. Sorry, I'm not trying to be too lengthy here, but she asked a very complex question. 35 major rivers and streams, and when it rains, in particular, the runoff, the sediment, the phosphorus loading will go down the rivers and creeks and end up in Lake Simcoe, and that will cause some of the cloudiness and the murkiness that you're seeing, particularly after the rain. So one of the things that we're trying to do to resolve that is put buffers along most of the water courses so that when heavy rains happen, that sediment won't get washed into the lake and contaminate the lake from the rivers. Mm-hmm. I hope that was somewhat helpful.
Sure.
Patrick?
I'll add in we should be pretty encouraged what we're seeing happen. As much as there are a few examples where it may appear that the lake is not as healthy, I think the work we've seen with the Lake Simcoe Conservation Authority is that things are getting a lot better. And for example, in the last 3 years, we've seen 6,500 trees and shrubs planted. The $30 million cleanup fund that was initiated has meant 100 funded cleanup projects in less than 3 years. I don't think we've seen that pace of activity at any time in the last few decades. So there is a real emphasis on Lake Simcoe right now. It's being funded, and if there is projects that we haven't identified that need to be identified for the cleanup fund, I know that the Lake Simcoe Conservation Authority will certainly have the support of our government, because we believe what they're doing is critically important to this region. It's the jewel, and we're very proud to be a partner with them. The only challenge we're facing, I'd actually suggest, is initially when the fund was set up in 2008, there was an overabundance of applications, an overabundance of projects identified. My only cause of concern is that in the last year, we've seen a real drop-off on projects being identified. So if you see something around the lake that you think seems astray, something that you believe needs to be worked on, please pass that on to the City of Barrie or the Lake Simcoe Conservation Authority, because we get our projects through these bodies. They're identified and voted on by the PROPEL committee, but the ones doing the work tend to be municipal bodies or the Lake Simcoe Conservation Authority. So we need to get more applications in to show that this fund obviously needs to be continued, because we're in the fourth year of a five-year fund, and I'm hoping if we continue a high level of activity on the Lake Simcoe cleanup fund, that we'll be able to show that this fund needs to continue for an additional 5 years.
That would be a good idea.
Anybody else like to weigh in?
Sure. The single best thing that the City of Barrie could do to clean up Lake Simcoe in the short term is actually one of the least sexy projects you can imagine. It's about stormwater management retrofit.
That's
so
right.
The short version of that is for 150 years, we believe the best thing to do with creeks and streams and stormwater in an urban setting was to put it into a culvert, box it, and get it to the lake as quickly as you possibly could. So all of the streams that are around Barrie, and there are 7 gales in the city of Barrie that feed right into Lake Simcoe, most of them, especially the ones that run through the older part of our city, are actually underground for a lot of their course through the urban area, or they're in concrete box culverts. It's only in the last little while that we have learned that that's actually the opposite of what you really should do in terms of the health of the lake.
Yeah.
Although that gets water, stormwater, down and into the lake faster, it also means there's no filtering whatsoever of all of those contaminants, whether it's road salt, it's not so much road salt anymore, but salt, oil, everything that's on those hard surfaces and parking lots and driveways around the city of Barrie. When we get a heavy storm, it all flows into the storm sewers, and then through concrete culverts, we rush it into the lake, unfiltered. So when you look at the outlet of storm sewers or the streams, Kids Creek, Hotchkiss, Bunkers, all the creeks around the lake, during the thunderstorm, it looks brown. You can literally see it pouring into the
lake. Oh, yeah.
With Kids Creek, and I think that was the first one, Gail, Kids Creek, we opened up the mouth of Kids Creek, and it was planted with vegetation that helps to filter what comes down the pipe before it gets into the lake. You can also do that at different places in the stormwater system. So every subdivision around Barrie has a stormwater pond. Some of them are soccer pitches or baseball diamonds when they're not full of water. But you can have the filtration right there. You can plant grasses, reeds, other vegetation that helps filter the stormwater before it gets into the system. So, like with many other things, it will take us many years and many millions of dollars to retrofit a lot of these creeks and storm systems that currently rush the water into the lake. But we have learned, and in recent years, with the Eco Park beside the Nautica buildings, with Kids Creek, with Hotchkiss next year, the naturalization of those creeks is a really critical part of protecting Lake Simcoe, mm-hmm. and it's something we need to do more of as a city.
Things is, first off, we eliminated the grass in our front yard. Our front yard now is totally indigenous local ground cover that requires no watering. And the water that comes off of our roof goes into rain barrels. We have 7 right now, plus a 1,000-liter storage tank as a backup that we use to water our vegetable gardens. Instead of using city water to do that, we're using the water off our roof. So it's not running down into those storm sewers and collecting more contaminants that get put into the lake.
Great.
Yeah, I guess you'll round out our discussion.
I might as well close it off here. yeah, everything that's a lot of the going backwards to go forward. We used to all have those water collectors or water collectors on the sides of our houses, and we use those to water our lawns. And getting rid of these lawns, we have to start to think about how we see the world and what we're looking at and what's beautiful to us. You know, all these big, huge extensive lawns, that's not going to help us in the future.
Thing.
We have to start to think about the ladies of the lake call rewilding. You know, rewilding are all the way around the lake so that we have
my
to protect
yard.
That water.
Rock University, I'm a third grade school teacher here in Barrie. Born and raised in early on Lake Uchichang, lived on Cedar Island Road. It was awesome. I mean, the water level used to be here. The water level is here now. I've never seen so many dead pike, perch, bass. I've never seen anything like it in my life. Me and my father built a bat right by where the port is, right by Lake Simcoe, right when you go through the buoys. We put 2x4s down with rocks and we built it, and there was bass coming there all the time, spawning. They don't come anymore. It's just covered with crap. And I just want to know, what can we do to make it come back to the way it was? The way when I came home from school where everyone, even the carp were swimming by spawning. And you couldn't catch them. You had to snag them if you wanted to. But what happened? I just want to know what happened.